Hello, and welcome again to Time Team Extra. It was the locals in Monty Python's Life of Brian who famously asked, "What have the Romans ever done for us?" Well, the answer is quite a lot.
Certainly that's what Time Team found when we dug a Roman villa site at Turkdean in the Cotswolds last summer, which, as I'm sure you'll agree if you saw last Sunday's programme, turned out to be one of our most successful digs yet.
Well, more of what the Romans did later, with my guest, Guy de la Bédoyère, historian and archaeologist. But I suppose the story really starts with the arrival of the Roman legions.
The Roman army invaded Britain in AD 43, arriving on the south coast. Here and there, particularly in Wales, they met with stiff resistance from the British tribes. In the south, they conquered more easily, rapidly establishing dominance through a series of garrison towns and roads. The pattern of their occupation was clearly seen from the air by Mick and Tony as they circled the Time Team site.
At present, we're flying over the line of the Fosse Way, which was one of the biggest Roman roads in England. And behind us is Cirencester, which was the biggest Roman town after London.
The interesting thing about the Fosse Way is it was almost certainly a frontier road and it was built about AD 47. To our right, down towards London and the southeast, seems to be the area that the Romans were interested in conquering because it was the wealthiest agricultural area, and they probably regarded the Severn Valley and Wales beyond it as hostile territory. And then later on, of course, as the country is pacified, it becomes a great artery between Exeter and Bath and Cirencester and Lincoln and York, running right the way up through the country.
So, Guy, what was the background to the Roman invasion? What persuaded them to cross the Channel?
Robin, there's no policy document that survives from the Roman period that tells us why they came here. But we do know that the Emperor Claudius, who'd become emperor in 41, desperately needed a military conquest, because in the Roman world, that was what made you an important and a conspicuous ruler. But Britain also had an awful lot of natural resources, and the Roman Empire was very dependent on minerals, metals like lead and silver and iron, all of which they knew were in Britain. And that was a good practical reason to come here.
This Roman army, this whole group of Romans that arrived in their boats, I mean, were they from Italy? What kind of background were they?
Well, the best way of describing that, Robin, is to think of how we use the word American. And America is a place full of all sorts of different numbers of people from all over the world who've ended up in America but living an American way of life. And the Roman army was filled up with people from all over the Roman Empire. And in fact, not very many from Italy. Most of them would never have been to Rome. And an awful lot of those soldiers, the legionaries, came from Gaul and Spain. But the Roman army was also made up of a kind of lower grade troop called the auxiliaries, who were raised in units from all around the empire, from Syria, from Thrace, from Germany.
So what was the effect of this invasion on the area around Time Team's villa site, Gloucestershire today?
Well, it's crucial to get across the point, first of all, that we're talking about a period perhaps 300 years before the Turkdean villa was actually built and in use. So it's a very different period of time. It's a military area. It's an area which is being built up by the Romans with roads crisscrossing the landscape and an awful lot of access to the new markets of the Roman world. And this proliferated out throughout all the people in the area, and it meant that ordinary people had greater access to the products of the Mediterranean classical world than had ever happened before.
So I suppose in the area that we're talking about, everything focused on the second largest Roman town in England, Carinium.
Well, that's absolutely right. And the Romans were part of a classical town-based world. Like the Greeks, their whole world was operated from town governments, little local city-states. But when they came to Britain, there weren't any towns or proper towns, so they literally had to make them. They had to make their own basic building blocks of a Roman classical Mediterranean world. And they would go along to the area of a native settlement. They'd set up a fort to control the area, mm-hmm. and that fort would attract all the social and commercial activities that had traditionally gone on in that region around the Old Iron Age settlement. And so eventually, a town began to grow up around the fort. When the Roman army moved on to conquer in Wales or the north and everything else, yep. that town stayed. And usually the Roman government would pick some of these towns to be instituted as the local government centre, a little bit like our county towns.
Well, while the towns were centres of civic power, the Romans also established a luxuriant lifestyle out in the country.
During the 2nd, 3rd and 4th centuries, a ring of villas sprung up around Carinium, modern-day Cirencester. The best known at Chedworth was excavated in the 19th century, but Time Team hoped to discover a brand new site near Turkdean.
Oh, look at that.
It's quite clearly laid out, isn't it?
Absolutely. It hasn't disappeared. And there's more stuff down here, look. Yeah. And then there's a corner down there. Okay, clear that. Oh, and look at these buildings down here, look.
They're separate, actually, from the main building, aren't
they? Yeah, well, they should be down towards... And there's something there by the spring, look. God, I hadn't noticed those on the ground.
Down on the ground, the geophysics team confirmed that this was indeed a vast site.
God,
what do you
Lord,
think of that?
That's absolutely fantastic,
isn't it? Absolutely astounding. I mean,
must be one of the clearest ones ever.
We've got the three ranges, and possibly a gatehouse, gardens
these
in the middle,
corridors and rooms up here.
Everything's so clear.
Sure enough, when digging began, the time team started to uncover the walls and rooms of a Roman villa.
Then we've got a wall here that probably would have been fairly low and maybe had small columns supporting a lean-to roof that would have covered this broad swathe here, which looks as if it's turning into a corridor.
Yeah.
And then up here we have got an inner wall, which has still got traces of plaster adhering to it. And that would then lead us into the main range of rooms that run up in this direction. These would have been the main domestic suites.
But the building just wouldn't stop growing. It marched off down the hill.
We've now extended the survey, and we're still gathering results. And it now looks to us as though we've got a third range coming across here.
So more walls down there?
More walls, a whole range of buildings.
Pretty soon, finds were being discovered thick and fast.
It's a nice piece, isn't it? It's your base or something. So first proper bit of pottery.
Tim's just found this in the spoil heap. So a brooch with someone's name on.
I think it's a roof finial. You see, it's decorated. It's got like four arches and like a little dwarf column coming up the top. So it's a piece of sort of decorative architecture.
Off the roof.
This was a villa from the 4th century heyday of Roman occupation. And it wasn't just big, it was also important. There was, for example, a posh bathhouse.
Yeah, and this is where you take your clothes off. It's a changing room.
Yeah, okay. I've done that. You're not seeing that.
Revealed by the geophysics, we've got three rooms in front of us. There'll be a cold room, a warm room, a hot room, with a big furnace heating the lot from that end. And then you come back through there, cool down a bit in the warm room, and then out here, and then you take the plunge.
But the villa wasn't all rooms for high living. It seemed it was also a working estate. Phil found the remains of a pewterer's workshop. And on the outskirts of the site, Terenza found farm buildings.
That's interesting. What's that?
This is sucking pig, baby pig. It's actually really nice because it's sort of high status
Absolutely.
Food.
Yeah.
We've had some deer as well. So we've got a possible hunting dog. So we've got sort of food preparation now, possibly
before
slaughtering
they've taken
as well.
Off to the house to be cooked. Perhaps,
so again, it's looking like sort of, you know, kind of ancillary support work for the villa rather than the sort of opulent occupation. It's the servants and slaves' quarters there.
Right.
But it was the bathhouse that continued to puzzle everyone. This may have been a villa, but it was certainly an unusual one.
What would a bath have been doing slap bang in the middle of the building?
Well, it's an odd place, isn't it, over on the end here. I mean, it hadn't ought to be in this range, had it, Neil, really?
No, it should be in the main house. So the man living in the main house doesn't have to come out in the open to get wet to have a bath.
So this isn't the main house?
Well, it all adds up, I think, to this being a slightly unusual collection of buildings, you know. It's not a normal villa, it doesn't have the normal rooms in it. It argues that it might be something completely different.
So there you have it, Guy. What do you reckon? Was it a villa?
Well, the Romans used the word villa to mean almost any kind of substantial place in the countryside, and that means a farm, it means an industrial estate, it even means my weekend cottage. And the Romans had a little bit of a fantasy about farming in the countryside, and the rich and wealthy Roman-type person would often own a place in the country and a house in the town. So to the extent that Turkdean is clearly a large building in the countryside, yes, it probably is a villa, but that doesn't mean that it didn't have other things going on there as well, like perhaps a temple, a shrine, something important that would have been of great significance to local people but was managed and looked after by the villa owner.
Right. Can we begin to understand the kind of people that would have lived there? Who were they?
Well, I mean, a tragic fact is that we don't know the name or the type of a single owner of a single Roman house at any time in Roman Britain. We just have to live with that. But the Romans were experts at getting other people to rule their own empire for them. And when they moved into a new province, they would get the local aristocrats literally to sign up as Romans. They would carry on being in power locally and owning the estates locally, but they would do it a Roman way. And the greatest likelihood is that Turkdean and Chedworth and many of these other buildings, which as you described earlier, surround the town of Cirencester, were owned by people who actually were bigwigs in the town. So these characters, having a large estate, would have the property qualification that entitled them to sit on the town council. Mm-hmm. And so they would go to the town, sit on the town council, and probably parcel up the local economy and the local laws all to their own advantage, yeah. Which helped rich people get a lot richer.
And what would life have been like on one of these massive estates?
Well, this person would probably have been able to trace his origins back to his Celtic forebears, but he and his family had modelled themselves distinctly on a Roman way of life, so they would have spoken Latin. They probably would have had some Latin books, but they would also have had hundreds, maybe in some cases, thousands of ordinary peasant homestead estate workers who would probably have occupied some of the little villages, and in fact there's one not very far from Turkdean, a few miles away, which appears to be a simple Romano-British village. And these people would have farmed the land all the way around the villa, coming perhaps to the house to be paid, coming to the house to receive their instructions, not necessarily from the owner, who might have moved away for the winter, he may have gone to live in the town, sure. And they would come along, and a bailiff operating the villa estate would be there instructing and operating the place.
To find out more about what went on in 4th century Roman Britain, join me again in part two, where I'll be visiting one of Turkdean's neighbours and taking a trip into town.
At last.
My favourite place, the kitchen. Welcome back. Now, Turkdean wasn't the only des res in Gloucestershire. Far from it. The Cotswolds seem to have been the equivalent of a Roman stockbroker belt. I've been out and about in the locality with Lindsay Allison-Jones, casting an eye over some of the local property. I started at Chedworth, now owned by the National Trust.
Chedworth Roman Villa. 2 bathhouses, central heating, living rooms, servants' block, and fine views down the valley. Sounds really like the top end of the Roman property market in Gloucestershire, doesn't it?
Hello, Robin. I'm up here at the Nymphaeum.
The Nymphaeum? Now that does sound interesting. Hello, Lindsay.
Hello, Robin. Typical time team weather, isn't it?
Absolutely. So this is the Nymphaeum?
Yes, this pool of water here is the Nymphaeum.
I hardly like to ask, would there have been nymphs in the Nymphaeum, you said, with a hint of lasciviousness?
Not literally nymphs, no. A Nymphaeum was a temple, a shrine, where the spirits of the water would be worshipped by the Romans. And of course, the water supply is very important for this particular villa, because this is why the villa is placed here, because they had a constant source of water.
It certainly is an incredible sight, this view stretching off down into the valley. It's a massive complex, isn't it?
What you've got here is the top range, the upper range, with the bath suites and the dining room. But it would have gone right the way down past the house to form sort of almost 2 courtyards.
Just like Time Team dug up at Turkdean, then?
Very similar, yes.
Yeah. Tell me, would they have treated this Nymphaeum as a wishing well and thrown coins in it?
They would have certainly thrown coins in to get the best wishes of the nymphs, yes.
Oh, come on, let's give it a go.
Okay. Oops.
Right, here's to the genius of this place.
Absolutely.
This is fascinating. Look, the site of the hot water boiler and the fuel store. And it's just like a modern house in so many ways, isn't it? I say, it's splendid, isn't it? This is the bathhouse.
This is the bathhouse. This is the changing room, yeah. Where you get stripped off and you'd leave your clothes neatly in a pile, and then you'd come out of there and into the bathhouse proper.
Trotting over your mosaics as you went.
Absolutely, yes.
It's a magnificent hypocaust.
Yes, it's a very good hypocaust system. You've got the piles of tile holding up the floor, and hot air would come in through that stokehole there and circulate underneath the floor and go up through the flue tiles. You can see the box flue tiles going up through the wall there. Yeah. That would take the hot air up into the walls and into the ceiling. And these bathhouses are very carefully organised with domed ceilings so that you don't get those horrible cold drips on you when the water condenses.
How ingenious. It ran down the sides.
Yes, yeah. It did, yes. With some of the public bathhouses, several of the emperors stopped mixed bathing because of misbehaviour.
Mind you, in wild Britain, things may have got really out of hand. So this is the dining room. I think this is the most magnificent mosaic I've ever been stuck in the middle of.
It's superb, isn't it? Yes.
Explain to me why this is more geometric and this is more pictorial.
Well, this part was where you actually had the couches and the tables with food. Mm-hmm. And this part was where you had the pictorial mosaic, which you'd use as a conversation piece so that when you had your guests, you could talk about the mosaic. Uh-huh.
Now, according to the guidebook, this is the best surviving one. I think there's one behind us as well. The four seasons being depicted.
Yes, a very popular theme in mosaics. But the winter figure here is very interesting because he's wearing a thick woolen cloak called a Burus Britannicus, which was one of Britain's famous exports in the Roman period. And, of course, very suitable wear for this sort of part of the world this time of year.
The beautiful Chedworth mosaics were made by craftsmen from Carinium, modern-day Cirencester. So next stop for us was a trip into town to visit the Carinium Museum. Room reconstructions there show what the inside of villas looked like. Lindsay was keen to explore the dining room.
Oh, you're not wasting any time getting in on the act, are you?
Very good, have a grape.
Have a grape. It strikes me as a little garish to modernise.
Yes, I think it's quite
this colour
complex and rather fussy decoration, mm-hmm. because you'd have patterns on the floor in mosaic. You then would either have a painted ceiling or mosaic on the ceiling, which would not necessarily match. It would be rather clashing. And then you've got these dark colours arranged on the walls, usually in three layers. So you have mock marble at the bottom.
A dado,
exactly. Yeah. Mm. And then you have the designs in patterns and blocks in the midway, and then you have a rail across the around the top,
like a border,
rail. Like a picture rail, yes. But it would be rather fussy and crowded, I think, to modern taste.
Up Pompeii and the like, you see them all lounging on nice plump stuffed cushions on the floor. Would that have gone on?
I don't think so in Roman Britain so much. We know that in Rome itself, people did recline comfortably in long padded things. Yeah. But in Britain, the height of the furniture and the way that the dining room seemed to be laid out suggests that people were more inclined to sit on a sofa like this or in a basket chair.
At last, my favourite place, the kitchen. What are you mixing up for us, Lindsay?
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, Robin, but this is not dinner. What I'm doing here is making up some medicines, because in a Roman kitchen was where the medicines for the household would be made. I've got coriander seeds in here, which I'm beating up, and then I'm going to mix it with wine for a corn cure.
Today's recipe would be one for frostbite.
Lion's fat mixed with rose oil is what Pliny would recommend, yes. That's the best thing to do. And you'll never guess what this parsnip was used for, Robin.
I daren't even hazard an opinion. Tell me.
Impotence.
As you can see, we had a good bit of fun over at the Carinium Museum. I suppose what I'm beginning to get the feel of is a society at Turkdean that was both, well, local and parochial, but also international in terms of trade and its economy. Is that right?
I'm sure that is correct. Most of the people who lived around here would probably have not gone very far from their villages or their homesteads, perhaps going to Cirencester occasionally to market. But the owners of the villas would probably have passed muster almost anywhere in the Roman world. And we do know from someone who lived about 100 years later in Gaul that he was able to describe the Celtic language as squama, a scurf, a kind of crusty thing that he and his elite people would have tried to throw off. So yes, these were an international jet set owning these very flashy houses, but with the vast majority of the population living and eking out their hard lives in the countryside.
Well, of course, history relates what happens to the greatest of empires, and the Roman Empire was no exception. So at Turkdean, there were a few finds and mysteries that showed that as the Western Roman Empire began to crumble in the late 4th century, so in Britain, the writing was on the villa wall.
In Trench 2, there was evidence that the villa had been systematically abandoned.
The final stage of the progressive abandonment is when the roof's fallen in, and there's roof tile on the ground, the walls have collapsed, there's walling stone all over the place, and there's some sort of possible squatter occupation, perhaps even a bit of industrial activity. We found slag, so they may have been smelting, and we found some very late Roman or possibly early Saxon pottery in that final layer.
And what had happened to that fine bathhouse?
But crucially, they deliberately filled it in, and that means, of course, they're doing something else on top of it. They're still occupying the site. They're going to build something else on top of this bathhouse.
And presumably the thing that was built on top of it might have been wood, so there would be nothing left.
It could well be, yeah.
That the villa was still being used late in the period of Roman occupation was in no doubt. One of the coins found was from the period of the last emperor to rule Britain.
What we've got today is absolute confirmation that this place was in use right through the 4th century. Nothing earlier still than the 270s, but we got lots of more in the middle of the 4th century, and then this one, which I think that's a coin of Honorius.
Sorry, you think it's a coin of...?
Honorius, who was the emperor that was in when the legions left.
So I've got a coin of Honorius too. I mean, I know he was one of the last Western Roman emperors, but what more do we know about him?
Well, Honorius spent most of his time holed up in a town called Ravenna in Italy at the very beginning of the 5th century, while the whole of Italy and Rome itself was being sacked by the Goths.
So that was Alaric, wasn't
That's
it?
That's correct. Yeah. So when the Britons started bleating for help and assistance, he really wasn't terribly interested. And so in the year 410, he actually told the Civitates, that's the local capital, the regional capitals of Roman Britain, that they'd have to look after their own defence. But in fact, his coins had stopped arriving in Britain a whole 8 years before that. So Rome was already really cutting off Britain. Most of the 4th century had been an attempt to shore up the empire. And one of the ways we can see the problems that the empire was up against is way back in the 3rd century. And I brought along some coins to show you. And if we start at the left here, this is a coin that is almost pure silver.
Yes.
But within only a couple of generations, the same denomination has gone through a rather degraded version here, which you can see is a bit tinny. And then it's almost completely bronze. So they've been trying to prop up their economy and trying to pay their soldiers with dodgy metal for a very long period of time.
So, did life in the villas continue? Did they stagger on for some considerable time, isolated from the continent?
Well, there's an increasing amount of evidence that some villas staggered on as private individual estates. But the vast majority, all these houses with mosaics and bath suites, by the last years of the 4th century, they're beginning to fall down. They're not being repaired. Some of them are actually burned down. We don't know whether that was a sinister burning down or just an accident. But whatever the point was, nobody came back to repair them. Sometimes people would live in and amongst the ruins. They may have been invaders, barbarians of some sort, or they may have been the original owners, forced to live in reduced circumstances in what remained of their houses. And by the time we get into the 5th century, about the time of the Honorius coin from Turkdean, there are virtually no villas being occupied in any kind of extravagant way. And after 50 years beyond that point, there are none at all.
So, Guy, looking back from 1,500 years later, what, in your opinion, is the Roman legacy to the present day?
Well, I think it's all around us, Robin. Not only is it in our language, but we've only got to look at a road map of modern Britain to see that the Romans created the infrastructure of the Britain we all live in today. Not only are many of our major roads lying on routes that were laid out by the very Roman soldiers that invaded this island in the year 43, but many of our most important historical towns sit on the sites of old Roman towns or Roman forts before that. And if you look at a pound coin, Robin, I've got one here, just look round the edge, you'll see the words Decus et Tutamen. And those words mean an ornament and a protection. And they come from Virgil's poem, The Aeneid. And Virgil was one of the greatest and most important Roman Latin authors in history. And most people will find that in their pockets today.
Well, civilizations come and go. And on this most civilized of programs, we must go too. My thanks to Guy for joining me. And don't forget Sunday's Time Team, when we travel to Mallorca and back in time 2,000 years before the Roman Empire. And see you all again next week.
And you can join the Time Team on their travels this Sunday at 6:25.